Tudo bom, pessoal? Muita gente fazendo pergunta para a gente com relação a essa questão do EB5. Muitas dúvidas surgiram, principalmente porque muitas pessoas começaram a nos procurar relacionadas a outros regional centers, que a gente muitas vezes nem sabia que existiam, trazendo problemas e situações onde essa nova situação do EB5, onde essa suspensão da atuação do EB5 fez com que outros problemas surgissem. E aí, eu convidei aqui a Chris Lee, minha sócia, advogada da Lee Toledo Law, e o Javier Lopes, da Cossack Troppin & Throckmorton, que é um outro escritório especializado em outras áreas, onde vocês vão entender durante esse vídeo, para que vocês possam entender como funciona o EB5, o que tem acontecido com algumas fraudes em EB5 e, principalmente, o que vocês devem fazer quando vocês detectarem esse tipo de processo. So, Chris, please introduce yourself.
Hi, Daniel. It's good to be here. I'm Chris Lee, and I'm managing partner at Lee Toledo in Washington, D.C.
Thank you. So, Javier, thank you very much. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you, Daniel. My name is Javier Lopez. I'm in Miami, and I'm the managing partner of the law firm of Cossack, Troppin & Throckmorton. So
good.
Thank you so much for letting me be here today.
You're more than welcome. So, Chris, let me ask you the first three questions. And the first one is, what is a regional center? Can you explain, please?
Yes. To briefly summarize what the regional center is, it's a opportunity for foreign investors to invest in a targeted regional center where for $500,000, you could invest and that could lead to a green card for you and your family.
Okay. And can you explain how a regional center is supposed to use the investors' money?
Well, that's a little complicated, but basically it's that you, when an investor invests the amount, whether it's $500,000 or $900,000, it should be in the form of an equity. But what happens is when you give that money, that investment is then used as a loan for the project. So then it becomes debt. And where the confusion is that sometimes when you are signing documentation, you may have documentation for equity holder as well as debt holder, but it may not be clear to you or disclosed to you by the people who you are investing the money with what you are. And that can lead to a lot of misunderstanding, as well as the possibility of fraud for what you are investing in.
Yes. So so your answer leads me to another question. So what are the differences between a loan investor and an equity investor?
Well, when you are a loan investor, you are giving the loan to the project. So you are holding debt. If you are an equity investor, you actually own part of the project and you will own a certain unit that entitle you to be an owner of that percentage amount as in that project. And I think that's why it's very important as a EB-5 investor, you read the documentation and you try to understand what interest do you really have and can that interest be converted? Because what I think a lot of EB-5 investors do not understand is that you could start out as an equity investor and then realize that you are actually holding debt that you didn't know about, or that the debt that you have is not limited to your $500,000 that you invested, but it could be greater. And it's all about disclosure. What is the sponsor or the regional center telling you? And are you signing for what you think you're signing for? And unfortunately, because not everyone is forthright with their disclosure, that can lead to fraud.
Good. Thank you, Chris. Javier, please, can you explain what is a Ponzi scheme, please?
Sure. So a Ponzi scheme has been around since the person that invented it. His last name was Ponzi. And basically, it's robbing Peter to pay Paul. The most infamous or the largest Ponzi scheme in the United States was one out of New York by Bernie Madoff. And I'm sure many people have heard about that. But basically, you have investors. You're selling them. In Mr. Madoff's case, he was a financial advisor. He was investing money and getting 10%, 11%, 12% returns. And he kept this Ponzi alive. This scheme alive for a long time because you get new investors and you pay the old investor. You get more investors and it keeps going like that until one day it blows up. My firm does a lot of financial fraud, Ponzi schemes, and we had the largest Ponzi scheme in Florida that was about $9 billion money in, money out, that was perpetrated by a lawyer in Fort Lauderdale. And he was selling structured settlement, saying, look, this is a plaintiff. There's a, it was a sexual harassment case against allegedly, you know, big CEOs, CFOs, and the company did not want it to come out. So they had this pre-suit settlement. And let's say the settlement was for $5 million. Well, what would happen is that the company does not trust the plaintiff, and the plaintiff or the victim does not trust the company to pay it. So they set it over, let's say, 10 years. What a structured settlement was is Scott Rossi would go, and by the way, there's perfectly legitimate structured settlements because the idea is a good one. A lot of these schemes that we can talk about start maybe with good intentions, but end up bad. This one started all bad. It was all fake. There was no there was no settlement. So he would say, okay, Daniel, I have this piece of paper. I have a settlement. It's for $5 million over 5 years. But my client, Miss Jane Doe, doesn't want to wait the $1 million a year. So she will take a big discount
to receive everything right now.
Right. So you, the investor, I'm selling you a $5 million guarantee. And here's where the scheme comes in. He had the fake bank accounts that showed that the money was in there. And I'll talk about the financial institutions in a second. But you give me $3 million, Daniel, and I'm selling you a $5 million, guarantee. Right. So he kept, selling those and selling those. And then when, in this case, it just got out of control. He was spending, he was spending $200,000 a month in clothing.
Wow.
In clothing. Wow. I mean, that's wild, watches. Yeah. So his life, he was just burning money. And then the meltdown, the real estate meltdown happens, and everybody wants their money back. Usually that's what happens. Something happens, the new money stops coming in, and it explodes because everybody's like, give me my money now. And they're like, there's no money left. So that's basically the Ponzi scheme.
Okay, thank you. So next question is, what should the investor do if he believes he was a victim of a fraud?
It's a good question. So the EB-5 program is ripe for fraud. There's a lot of EB-5
fraud,
Ponzi schemes, and fraud.
Yes.
Because the program's a good one, right? It's supposed to be a win-win.
Yeah.
You are a foreign investor.
The program is good, but the regulation was made by a five-year-old kid.
So what happens is it's ripe for fraud because you've got a lot of money coming in and not a heck of a lot of oversight. We have an EB-5 scheme where the idea was to build a ski resort in Vermont, and they actually started building it, but they were getting more money in from the investors and taking more money out, and before you knew it, it was unsustainable and it blew up. So if you believe that you have been a victim or are a victim of fraud, I'd call a lawyer preferably specializes in this sort of work. I would not call the person that you think is defrauding you.
Of course.
Because
are you committing fraud against me just to make sure that
they're
in the same thing?
Sometimes what they do is, they're very good. I mean, these people talk a lot. They're very, like the case that I was talking about that we had here, one of them here, the Scott Rossi. Scott Rossi was very charming, very good salesman, and he knew how to sell. So they're convincing. I would call a lawyer that does this type of work that can do an investigation, or due diligence, if you will, into this. And sometimes we work on a parallel track with the prosecutors. In this case, it would be federal prosecutors, because obviously it's a federal regulation.
Yes.
In my office, for example, we have one of my partners who's a former United States attorney for, I think, 11 years. And so we have a really good relationship with them. And if it's something that we think has teeth, we reach out to the United States Attorney's office and say, hey, look, this is what we have found. This is what's going on, in a nice, wrapped up in a bow, to kind of help move the process along quickly.
Daniel, can I just say something? I think another tell is if they're getting reports back and 10 jobs for your investment are not being created, that's a big clue that there is something amiss. And so when you get these reports from the regional center, they should be looking at it to see, is my investment creating jobs? Because that's one of the things that USCIS will look to see whether or not you can get approved for the green card.
Yes. Yes. Good. Very good, Chris. So, Javier, can we sue the regional center and the financial institution? I believe you should explain the difference between them and why.
The answer is yes. We can sue. Obviously, this is a civil yes. lawsuit, not again.
Because the regional center is one thing, right. And the financial institution is another one, right? They are separate. Right. They're not the same thing.
Correct. The financial institution, for example, the case I was telling you about the ski resort was Jay Peak, large investment bank. In the Scott Rothstein Ponzi scheme, we had Bank of America, Gibraltar Bank, and TD Bank. And you're like, well, why are you suing the financial institution? Well, usually these elaborate schemes, it's pretty hard for one person to do. And in this case that I'm telling you about, I'm not saying that, all of TD Bank was in on it, but usually there's a couple, one or two that we're able to identify that assisted. And I can tell you the stories about how these two particular, I think one of them is in prison actually, how they assisted, and it's remarkable. Why do we do that? Because that's the deep pocket. Because Scott Rothstein was in prison. He had gotten arrested and he's sitting in jail, and all the money he got, he had blown. You know, that money, he spent it on cars and, you name it, homes and planes. And like I said, hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of clothing. So, I mean, he was spending like $3 million a month. So that, the really bad guy is sitting in jail or in prison and doesn't have the money. Now, the financial institutions, our allegation was that they aided and abetted. So they knew or should have known that this was a fraud, that this was too good to be true, for example, and that they didn't follow, in this case, certain protocols that would have absolutely told them there's something wrong here. We need to look at this. And they ignored those red flags. So the legal claim there is aiding and abetting, helping, assisting, helping the scheme continue. Even if they helped it continue for a little bit, they can be on the hook. And obviously, if you've got a, there's two kind of parts of a case, which is number one, the liability and the damages, the trial, assuming it gets to trial. In these large cases, we've settled. They don't want to go to trial. They have a lot to lose because we go for punitive damage. But let's assume that you do go to trial and you get this humongous judgment, many, many, many zero. Well, great. But that's just a piece of paper. The next step that a lot of people forget is the collection. My piece of paper that says Javi's owed $100 million is basically worthless unless I have somebody, the defendant, that I can go and collect from. So usually these financial institutions obviously have the wherewithal to pay these judges. So when we investigate an EB-5 Ponzi scheme, whether it's viable is really based on multiple things. One is liability. Was this really a fraud? And then, okay, let's assume all of that goes well. Can we collect for our victims? Can we collect for our clients? Because, we do these cases on a contingency basis, and we're the one taking the risk, putting the money to litigate, and we want to make sure that that we win and that we collect.
So, Chris, what else do you think it's important to be said here? So,
I think what's important is that you have to go with your gut. I mean, many investors may be in this 2-4 years and thinking, wow, this doesn't seem right. I should have gotten my conditional approval. I should have gotten this. But, they're always being told by the regional center or the attorney that was involved, like, oh, just wait. I think people should be aware that if it doesn't seem right, it's probably not right. And if something that was supposed to be built within a certain time period is not built, that's really bad.
Yes.
And so I think people have to understand that they may not understand the rules and regulations of this program, like the attorneys or the regional center, but you should have the common sense to know if something does not seem right, it probably isn't. And
it's
you should start, yes. And you should start contacting attorneys, or any attorney, I think, that you trust may be able to guide you towards someone like Javier Lopez, who can say, hey, you know what, let me look at the documents and see if something is wrong or there's fraud, because it's a very specialized field and it's very complex. And not everyone can make an assessment and be able to tell you, because sometimes these are very, very sophisticated people who know what they're doing to deceive. And so you have to find just as qualified people to see where the wrongdoing is. And it may be something as simple as not being told that they didn't disclose it. And that may be your case.
Perfect.
If I could just add to that, I think that, Chris raises a couple of very good points. you know, first, if something seems too good to be true, it probably is. You know, in the cases that I'm telling you about, there are some really, really sophisticated investors that were swindled. And, you know, some people say, well, you know, maybe it's greed on you know, the investor's part. But if something's too good to be true, it probably is. The second point that Chris raised, that's a very good one, is that, well, maybe, you know, when I said earlier, we'll contact a lawyer that does this. Well, you might not know, right? Because it is pretty niche and specialized. But Chris's point about, okay, contact someone you trust. I'm sure you probably know a lawyer, or somebody that you know that you trust knows a lawyer. You know, we're kind of all over the place. We're like a mole, right? Somebody that can get you there, that you trust. That's really, really the key. Once you identify that person, they can get you hopefully to the right professional that does this type of work.
Good. Thank you very much, Javier. Chris, thank you very much again. Pessoal, eu espero que tenha resolvido aí, esclarecido uma série de dúvidas que vocês poderiam ter. Como eu disse para vocês, existiam nos Estados Unidos mais de 1,000 centros regionais aprovados e eu diria para vocês que 600 deles hoje estão com grandes problemas financeiros e problemas que acabam gerando problemas também para aqueles que investiram. Então eu vou deixar aqui na descrição para vocês os contatos do Javier para que vocês possam entrar em contato com ele caso vocês achem que o centro regional no qual vocês investiram possa estar em algum problema com o Ponzi Scheme, que nós conhecemos no Brasil como a estrutura da pirâmide, né? Isso é muito conhecido no Brasil com esse nome. Eu vou deixar aqui os contatos dele para vocês. Mandem um e-mail para ele, entrem em contato, façam as perguntas, com certeza absoluta. Ele vai poder dizer se esse centro regional tem algum tipo de problema, se o seu contrato tem algum tipo de problema, se eventualmente o seu processo pode ter algum tipo de problema relacionado a essa fraude. Grande abraço a todos, fiquem com Deus. Obrigado.